Confucian, young students who have assembled here today for the celebration of the International Council of Meridians. For the celebration of the International Meridians Day, which was introduced long back in 1992 by the International Council of Meridians. This is celebrated all over the world by museums of different kinds in different countries. And here, some of the museums in this country, like the ICOM, like Indian Museum, Victoria Memorial, probably they will be also celebrating this occasion. I was asked by Islam to talk on this topic, role of museums in a changing society. And the society changed not just very recently, it has been changing. It's a present continuous tense, it has been changing for many, many years, for many centuries. And if we go back not to distant the past, but at least 200 years from hence, we find the museums changed considerably during this period. And now we are foreseeing further changes in the concept, in the contents, concept, presentation, philosophy of museums. I shall not bore you to this subject, because on this subject one can go on talking and talking forever. I shall be very brief and try to make it as simple as possible so that the young students understand this very well. The picture that you find here, this looks something like Birla Museum from the front. But it is not that. This is believed to be the oldest museum in the world. I said believed to be because any kind of priority claim is dangerous. The moment you say this is the oldest museum, immediately somebody will come up with a record. Then there is maybe some obscure references in some of the places in Madagascar or in Honolulu, or any other place that the museum existed before that. But this one accepted as the oldest museum, the Ashmolean in Oxford, 1677. Okay. The reason that I decided to choose here, that if I consider this period from 1677 onwards, we have to trace really the development of museums all over the world, starting from this day, what changes have taken place in different places, and even what changes have taken place in the Ashmolean itself. Did I come to respond? Yes. Very briefly. When we talk about origin of museums, you know, this subject has been very extensive for our museology colleagues, very extensively dealt with by Alma Bickley in his book, which has become these days almost a textbook in different museology courses. The museums originated from royal or feudal cultures, the start. Then some museums, they came up, they originated from exhibitions or world fairs. Further, after some time, the museums came up from private collections. And lastly, primarily from 1969 onwards, the museums have developed with created exhibits. The first three are collected exhibits. that means the artifact based. But the last one created exhibit, which started from two institutions, the Exploratorium in San Francisco, opened in 1968, and then in 69, the Toronto Science Center in Toronto. Now, they are different. Here in Birla Museum, you'll find both collection-based exhibit halls and exhibit halls with creative exhibits for explaining, primarily in science areas, for explaining how, why, what of science. Now, the changes took place in the museums, starting from these royal or feudal collections, and gradually, after maybe a couple of centuries, from exhibitions and world fairs, and then gradually the private collections started coming in, and as I said, the creative exhibits, theater exhibits from 69 onwards. Sorry, I'm pressing the wrong button. Now, I'm giving some very brief examples for the people who probably do not know much about these institutions. For the first category of museums, which are based on royal collections or feudal collections, right? The kings or kings or emperors of different countries, or very big officials, something like in our country, jamindars. So feudal lords, they assembled huge collection of art materials, artifacts. And then these collections, at some point of time, they became part of public museums. Some of them were opened as public museums. The palace itself, the picture on your left that you see, Versailles Palace, the palace with all its internal decorations, the palace itself became the museum. And some others, which on the right, that shows the collection of artifacts, that is the famous Kremlin jewelry collection over there, the museum which has the costliest collections in the world, and that's why it is not a public museum. I mean, the people cannot simply escape in that museum from the street. It requires special permission, and that is given only to special people like that. So this is in the Kremlin. The whole museum is full of diamonds and precious materials with lots of gold, that kind of thing. So one example I have shown you, the palace itself turned to a museum. The other one, the collections, individual collections, they were taken in a palace and then it was made a museum. But museums of two different kinds. Originally, there were some museums which were not open to public. They were called ivory towers. Ivory towers. The collections were there. Well, you could call it museum, but not for general people, only for some privileged classes. Now, the royal palace, then gradually in different countries, they were converted to public museum, and I'm showing only one example, but there are probably 30, 40 prominent examples, and this example is Louvre, the big and famous museum in Paris. And I decided to show you two pictures. The one on the left is a typical sculpture hall. You see the typical sculpture hall. The palace existed with the columns. In between the columns, they decided to put the standing sculptures over there. So it became a part of the building itself. And on the right, it is a typical painting hall. And there you see the painting created on the roof of that exhibit hall. and also the framed paintings which are hung on the wall on two sides over here. Two different kinds of paintings. One painting done in situ on the roof over there. The other one painting done on canvas or some other medium, and then framed and then hung on the wall. Now this is just one example. I'm still really roaming through these royal palaces and talking about the royal collections which were the owners of today's museums. Then we come to the second group of, the first change that took place after the royal collections. Then the museums were built from various exhibitions. They were primarily industrial exhibitions, various objects collected. So I'm giving examples, only just one or two, without boring you. This example is on your left, the famous Crystal Palace exhibition of 1851, from which, now exhibitions are temporary. After some time, the people who brought the materials for the exhibition will take it away. So here, some of the things, some of the precious items from this exhibition were not taken away by the owners of these artifacts, and they were transferred to a museum which is called Victoria Albert Museum in South Kensington. On the right you see that. And then some of the collections on science, relating to science, were further transferred from Victoria Albert Museum to the Science Museum, called a separate science museum, almost next to that building in South Kensington. So this is just one example. There are many examples. I can mention another example over there. The Philadelphia Expo of 1875, Philadelphia Expo. The collections from there were taken, after the exhibition was over, the collections were taken to form the art and industry, to fill up the art and industry building of the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C., which you find on the right, the first building of the Smithsonian. Now it has grown into an empire of many buildings on many different subjects, but this was done like that. So we started with royal and feudal collections. Then a change was incorporated into the museum when the temporary exhibitions provided materials for display to form new museums, permanent museums. There is another interesting example which appeared to me, that we are talking in the earlier case, this Philadelphia exhibition to Smithsonian or Crystal Palace exhibition to South Kensington, we talked about the artifacts moved from the exhibition to form a museum. But I would like to give some examples. Again, I just stick to two brilliant examples where the building and infrastructure created for World Fair, that really was transferred to form new science centers, new museums over there. Not the artifacts, not the individual small items of, importance of art, not that, or importance of science. The building, the whole building, that was created not for the museum, that was created for a temporary exhibition, World Fair. The World Fair held in Seattle in 1962 became the home of Pacific Science Center. After this thing is over, the people decided, oh, beautiful things are built up over there, let us use it for setting up a permanent museum over there, Pacific Science Center. 2 years later, in 1964, the World Fair was held in New York, and after the World Fair was over, they decided to transfer this property to form a new science center there, which is called today New York Hall of Science. The front portion was built later on, but the back portion, this tall thing, they were built in 1964, in fact. attempted to mention, I have been associated with this organization since 1964, since that day. I mentioned about the Ashmolean. Over the years, just brief example. On the left, you see old display of sculpture. Again, you remember in the picture showing Louvre, I showed you that building, the palace was built with columns appearing there, and in between the columns, they decided to put the sculpture. So the sculpture became a part of the building. Looks like that. Here in Ashmolean, it is like that. Here you don't find that kind of column, that kind of gorgeous columns over there, because the building is smaller, they're sitting high and lower. But you have the columns, and in between the columns, you have the standing sculptures. This was the old display of sculpture, and this style of display is still retained even today. But the new display, which is the current display of artifacts, artifacts means the small objects, small things of importance. For that, if you look at the right, you find this kind of display is still done even in different museums. And you will find that in Indian Museum, you find that in National Museum, a pedestal below, and then glass case with some kind of frames. Frames are sometimes made of wood, sometimes made of steel, you know, and the exhibit which is on the wall, you will find a similar kind of display. It's done by museums of different countries, of different subjects. So this is the current display of artifacts where there are changes over there. Why the changes took place? I will come to that point now. I'm showing this to you to remind you, because all the time I'm talking about New York and Seattle and Washington DC and Bali and Oxford. What about our own city, Calcutta? The Indian Museum on your left and Victoria Memorial on your right, two distinguished museums of the city over there. And you will find plenty of valuable artifacts in Indian museums. Some of them are very, very old artifacts relating to Gandhara period or so. And in Victoria Memorial, the colonial period primarily, you will find both of them. And they came from the private collections. Usually, I'm not meaning from the so-called royal collections, but from the private collections. What about the third group I talked about after the private collection? In between private collection and the royal collection, I talked about the exhibitions. Now it is very interesting for me to know that some materials of Indian Museum were collected from an industrial exhibition held in Eden Garden in 1877, and they formed really a big part of the exhibition hall in Indian Museum. So Indian Museum was set up partly from the private collections, partly from industrial exhibitions. For my colleagues in NCSM, I will mention a very important exhibit and exhibit hall here in Birla Museum was an outcome of an industrial exhibition. In 1956, there was a very big industrial exhibition in Delhi where a lot of industrial houses participated. And for the first time in the country, 1956, for the first time in the country, television was brought in by Philips over there. The old image iconoscope camera, big tower, you know, very cumbersome thing. That was brought here in 1956. And then my predecessor, Mr. Bose, he was so much enchanted by that one, he persuaded the Philips to leave it here in India, not to take it back to Holland after the exhibition was over. And finally, we got this information from Philips and set up a separate television gallery here in Birla Museum on the upper floor, on the second floor, television gallery. So with something which came from the industrial exhibition. That remained here for a long time. And that was the period when television was not known in the country. I mean, there was no public television, no Doordarshan, no, not to speak of the subsequent commercial channels. Now, we have to sum up these major changes in the museums, why it took place. The first thing that comes up in my mind is the factor which is called public accountability with democratization of the society. We talked about the royal collections and feudal collections, that sort of thing. Before the French Revolution or the concept of democracy, true democracy, when we learned about that phrase, democracy for the people, of the people, by the people, that kind of thing. Much before that, the collections originated. I told you about the royal and feudal collections. Now, with more and more democratization of the society, it gradually went on. If we say that starting from the French Revolution and then going on, then talk about the Russian Revolution of 1918, then you talk about the post-Second World War, when a large number of countries in Asia and Africa became independent from the colonial rules and set up their own, had their own democratic setup in their own countries. So the process of democratization of the society was very massive at that time, and that resulted in complete different outlook for the museum. What is that? Because that time it says that the money is not coming from the king, money is not coming from big zamindars or feudal lords, money is coming from state exchequers. And in a democratic society, that means money is coming from the people. You, me, something like that, all ordinary people, from the taxes that they pay, ultimately some part of that one is coming for building up of the museum. So what should be there in the museum for the benefit of these people and not for the benefit of one or two landlords, feudal lords, or maybe one or two or a few big scholars? This town was used at that time, Ivory Tower. Living in a tower, completely dissociated from the grassroots and doing research over there. They are very happy with the contents of the museum, which was beyond the reach of the common people. So, from this period onwards, late 19th century and then 20th century, and particularly after the Second World War, during 1950s, 1960s, considerable changes took place in the approach in the museum to make the museum more and more people-friendly. First, to make it accessible to the people at large. They developed the whole museum in such a manner to invite large number of people, to captivate large number of people in the museum, and to serve the people. So, this was a very major change in the museum, resulting from the change in the society. So Ivory Tower took public places of interest. All the museums became public places. And as if that the common people were owning the museum, this was considered to be their own places. Now when it came up there, there was a big difference came up in the contents and the presentation of the museum. In the sense, earlier the museums were places only for scholars. Scholars, they were very wise people, scholars of particular subjects. So their view was always subject oriented. So in the science museums that they built up over there at that time, or they supervised museums at that time. What about the galleries? The galleries were on motive power, on transport, you know, maybe different automobile gallery, maybe a museum on ship. All subject-based, subject-oriented approach with which the scholars were very comfortable, like in art. you know, the old galleries they did in museum, Gandhala art, bronze gallery, painting gallery. You know, they were all on specific subjects, the subjects of specialization of the wise men, the scholars. But when the museums were expanded, and from the hands of the scholars, they passed on to the people, ordinary people. They were not scholars, and the museum had to be served, to be serving to them, the ordinary people. So the concept of thematic presentation came over there. And that came up first in science museums. I still remember this beautiful, the big change in the thematic side came up in the, probably for the first time, but somebody can differ something earlier than that. Probably for the first time in the Natural History Museum in London, back in 1960s. And the galleries were all Ligon. Earlier it was like invertebrates, you know, the insects, birds, mammals, all subject-wise, the typical zoological approach of the museum. But in 1916, the museum completely changed their approach and came up with thematic display on gallery over there on a particular subject of, say, relating to ecology, relating to the environment of a particular place. And there, everything came up over there, the invertebrates and vertebrates and reptiles and birds, everything of that biome, the whole thing came up over there in that gallery. So this thematic display, I'm tempted to give one example to you. What I say, the subject-wise galleries were something like sculptures, stone sculptures, one gallery, bronze sculptures, one gallery, the painting, one gallery, the coins, one gallery. Coins are having a distinct gallery. Like that, they were having different subject-wise galleries. I found back in 1980s a brilliant gallery in Israel. The gallery was on hairstyles through the ages in Israel. Hairstyle through the ages. What kind of different styles of hair for men and women we find from the different art materials. And there in the same hall, it was stone sculpture, it was painting, it was medallion, it was small coins, it was a stamp, postage stamp. All different kinds of materials. They were not divided subject-wise. They were collected on that theme, hairstyle, which depicted the hairstyle. And that came up very well. That was a very popular gallery which remained there for a long, long time. So, like that, there could be many examples. I want to stop this discussion here, but I wanted to make this, that with this democratization of society, passing of the baton from the hands of the scholars to the ordinary people, the whole approach was changed from the subject-based galleries to thematic display. And then came a very big change in the concept of the museum, what I call as total education. I do not say just education. Why total education? I will come to the next slide, but just here I will mention, you know, the museology students, they deal with this thing. What is the purpose of a museum? The function of a museum? Collection of materials, then documentation. I mean, doing nice words, where from they were collected, all the detail. Then the conservation, documentation, research, so and so. Conservation, keeping it in good condition forever, like that. Then exhibition. And then exhibition, with that one they attach education. That means in the exhibition there should be a lot of educational component over there. So education was considered traditionally as one of the functions of the museum. And this is something, a big change came into the concept of education in the 1970s that I found. And at that time I was very, very active in the international museum field. In 1970s, the whole world, the concept was changed. They said, no, education is not just a function of a museum. It is the dominant function of the museum. That means they felt that collection for education, documentation for education, conservation for education, exhibition for education. Education is the key role, education is the key factor behind all functions of the museum. To me, that was a very, very big change, because that led to considerable changes in exhibit collection, exhibit fabrication, design fabrication, where we talk about created exhibits and presentation over there. It brought in a very big change in the concept. So when we talk about this purpose of museum, what I said, education is not just another function of a museum like collection, documentation, exhibition, etc. Education has an overriding role that came up in 1970s, that concept. It is a primary, purpose. It is a primary purpose of a museum. That was a big change in the concept. Again, from the democratization, the whole thing is coming up like that. Now, when it came up, I still remember in 1960s, when I started visiting museums, particularly in Europe and America. Well, many people said, yes, we are having education in our museum. We are having guide lectures. So at that time, guide lecturing in the museum was considered the only educational activity. So what I said, I witnessed that scenario. Once upon a time, education meant guide lecture, nothing else. Audio visuals started with slides and films, nothing else. I'm talking about early 1960s. Audio visuals means slide projector, the old Kodak projector with 35 millimeter slide and 16 millimeter film. That's all, the end of audio visual. And as I say, education means guide lecture. Computerization really came afterwards, towards the end of 1970s, beginning of 1980s, it was meant for word processing, even not visuals. Computers were introduced in the museum. Then, when we started talking about immersive visualization, it meant only panoramic projection. Immersive visualization means multi-screen, some kind of 9-screen or 7-screen, 9-screen, 11-screen projection all around my place. I'm standing there at the center and looking at the different screens are coming up there. That is immersive visualization. And from there, we are going over to the concept that it is an ongoing process, total education. Where does it lead to the total education? These things are changing fast now, these days. We are now having new kinds of museums. One is storytelling museum, that is my current fancy. The other one, immersive visualization, not merely just a multi-screen projection, much, much more than that. I will not be very much details in that, but I'll mention very quickly, hands-on and minds-on exhibits. We started talking hands-on from 1969, from Exploratorium, from Frank Oppenheimer. We knew what is hands-on. We started developing hands-on exhibits here in India, and we feel proud that at one time, beginning of 1980s, India was considered the only home of hands-on science centers next to two institutions, the Exploratorium and Toronto Science Center. There was no hands-on science center in Europe, nothing in America, in other places at that time, but we had it in Nehru Science Center, we had it in Birla Museum, we had it in Visheshwara Museum, that kind of thing. And from there, we developed the concept of mind soul exhibits gradually. And then today, NCSM primarily is doing enormous work on interactive digital support. Now, through this, it's a big change in the museum. While this change is going on, my colleagues in the museum profession, many of the people, museum profession, not science museums alone, art museum, history museums, different kinds of museums, they say, oh, these things are possible only in science museums. You know, because computer is something relating to science, you can have computer only in science museum. In our museum, how can you use that one? Art museum, archaeology museum, history museum, you cannot have science museum. I was feeling tired in arguing with my colleagues like that. So when I retired from this place, I thought that I would concentrate on this interactive digital support in history museums. The people say, it cannot be done. Let us see how it can be done, and it can be done very well. So first thing was this town hall, small thing in town hall, then in Parliament Museum, then something is coming up in a very big manner in Rasavati Bhavan. Now today, what National Council of Science Museums is doing, they developed a museum on Buddhism. Is it a subject of science? The people say, you can have your technique only in science museum. So how can National Council of Science Museum develop an international museum outside India, in some other country, on Buddhism? How can National Science Museum presently be working to develop a big history exhibition on Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, and through enormous exhibits on interactive digital support? The point is that these tools are scientific tools. True, they started first in science museums, but they are very useful tool for art museum, archaeology museum, history museum, museums of different kinds. They are very, very good instrument for making such museums much, much more attractive. The earlier the people understand that, the better for the museum. I would very quickly mention that when we're talking about the storytelling museum, that is my favorite topic these days. Everywhere I'm trying to set up that one. Why do we need a storytelling museum? Not necessarily for the science museum, for art museum, for archaeology museum, for history museum, a storytelling museum. First thing is attraction and retentivity. Attraction, it attracts the people in a very big manner. The people are fond of listening to this, from the youngsters to the quite aged people, you know, we are fond of stories. And if the stories are not to be read only, if the stories, we can have the storytelling in different format, particularly in the digital format, in different ways. Okay, I'm not going into details of that one. The people who are doing Sardar Patel exhibition, they know this well. So it would be much more attractive. And when it is attractive, attraction is not the only factor that is to be considered. Retention of the visitor, that means for longer period. If for a museum, a person spends about 1.5 hours for a museum, with this kind of storytelling approach, he will spend 3 hours. He would spend 4 hours. He would stay there. He would come back again. He would talk about that museum to his friends and relatives who were there and encourage them to visit that museum. So that kind of thing, attraction and identity, is very important. One thing is collection gaps. Doesn't matter how big is the collection, how rich is the collection of a museum, there is always a gap. And this gap can be filled up only with very good digital stories over there in different formats, so that you have a continuous story. One exhibit, one artifact, then a beautiful story linking that to the next artifact, and it goes on through the entire gallery. And this one makes that contextual reference. An object has come, this beautiful piece of art object, I put it there. Another object, beautiful piece of art object, I put it on this. And there is no connection between this. Individually, each of them is brilliant. Collectively, they do not pass on any message to me. That has been always the situation in museums. Now with this storytelling approach, when you connect all the exhibits with a nicely, closely neat story, you have all the contextual references presented before the public. Socio-economical relevance of the exhibits. A particular thing, like a particular sculpture, it was a Buddha icon, fine. When was it done? Who did this one? What kind of sculptures were there? Were there only Buddhist monks who were captivated during the monsoon in a cave, could not move out, so just for pastime they started painting that all big frescoes in Ajanta? Was it the situation like that? I mean, we have to know under what condition, by whom these objects of art were created. So this is something called the socio-economic relevance of that particular art object. This is necessary to be listed here. And there, all of them, if it is done nicely, then they result in repeat visits. Now this concept of storytelling museum, I would say, I observed over there, came up only during last 10 or 12 years. During this time, I saw brilliant treatment of storytelling in the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C., in the Holocaust Museum, in the George Washington's farmhouse, in Lincoln Museum in Springfield, Illinois. Brilliant storytelling approach over there for presenting a particular episode of that. And I feel the present work, which is being done by NCSM on the Patel exhibition, could be a brilliant storytelling exhibition. Now, when we talk about hands-on exhibits, again, it originated from Exploratorium in 1969 by Frank Oppenheimer. And all over the world in science museums, we have science centers, hands-on science. Again, my friends, they said, oh, it is possible only in science museums, in science centers. It is not possible for art museums, for archaeology museums. What can I do for hands-on activities there? Now, this is a very long idea, and that's why I put it up over there. This concept of hands-on, completely different, again, different from the glass case. We come out with something placed on the table and to be handled by the visitors, something that is to be done. And I am showing only one picture. There are many instances like that. Smithsonian Institution is primarily, this is in National Museum of American History. It is a history museum. History museum based on collected artifacts, collected art objects over there. And there's a brilliant gallery over there. It's called Hands-on History. So they demonstrated over there how hands-on activities can be incorporated in the history museum as well. I'm talking about the period settings as a part of the storytelling museum in different places, you know. It's not a diorama. It is creating a particular event, particular situation. I'm showing you two examples. The one on the left is Lincoln Museum in Springfield, Illinois, not Springfield, Virginia. Lincoln Museum. This lady sitting over there is not a living person over there. The whole thing is created in a very typical setting of farmhouse, whole thing is created. The people can go through that one. It is not to be seen from outside. It's a walk-through experience. The people can go through that one, and everything is very faithfully created in a period setting. The same kind of thing on the right side you find in Parliament Museum in Delhi, the kind of thing that is created over there. That relates to the famous partition of Bengal movement of 1905 in connection with that state. If you consider a much larger stage setting thing, you know, in Lincoln Museum, this is the cabinet of Abraham Lincoln. Abraham Lincoln is standing on the left side, and his cabinet members, they are discussing things on the table. Now, they are all these photographs, sculptures sitting over there, and the people, the visitors can go through this, they can enter into that room, pass through that one, they can touch the sculptures, they are allowed to do that one, and have a feel about that particular environment, that stage setting that is going on over there. And if you look at the Parliament Museum Delhi, as a kind of stage setting, this is a recreated portion of the central hall of Parliament. Midnight scene of 1947. The people who were present there and what happened during that time when India became free, the freedom was announced. If you look at that one, the current people, they are sitting side by side with those people who were sitting there in 1947. There are other aspects of presentation. But I'm saying that if you look at that one, you would be confused. Which one is alive like Manmohan Singh, and which one is not alive? For example, Kalam is alive, but next to him is sitting Radhakrishnan. Radhakrishnan is not alive. He is of historical past. Like that, on the extreme left, if you find Advani is sitting next to Shyama Prasad Mukherjee over there. Now, this is the kind of illusion that is created not through digital process. There are ways of doing that one in digitally, but physically you create through the stage setting. This is an example in the Smithsonian Institution where the artifact is that streetcar, and the things that the fiberglass sculptures of the people, the passengers, they are standing, and the living visitors, they are getting mixed up over there. So living visitors are passing through that one, they are riding on the streetcar, and they get mixed up with then the creative exhibits over there. So creating a kind of walk-through period setting. This creates a feeling of a particular situation. The same kind of thing in Parliament Museum in Delhi, in patriotic songs sung by the people during that period when India was approaching freedom just a few years before 1947. The people were on the street, they were dancing, they were singing. And along with that one, the electronic part was that collection of patriotic songs which were sung at that time on the streets in 22 different languages here in India, and the people can have choice over there. They can press a particular button for a language and they can choose a particular song in Punjabi, in Karnataki, in Santali, in Goanese, and in different kind of languages. Now, with this, I'm coming to the end. Current challenges. What are the current challenges here with the continuously changing society? I'm not discussing that one. What is changing in the society? You must be having a feel of that one. What I am going on about, that this changes in the society, how they are reflecting on the region. The first point, to me, it appears very important. Self-sustenance gives clear autonomy. The museum, a lot of museums, they complain they are not having sufficient financial support from the government. Things end up run by the government. And that's why they are under enormous government control. This is a normal feeling of the museums over there. So they cannot serve the community very well. To me, what is important is that autonomy comes from self-sustenance. If I can generate income enough to give support to the museum, I don't need to look at the government at their mercy. I can defy the government and do things which will be truly useful, beneficial for the people in the Indian society. This is very important because I'll come to the end to show a brilliant example for that. The second thing is that museums are having right now. Why they are not becoming self-sustaining? Self-sustaining museum means they will have to increase their income enormously. How can they increase their income? The only way of increasing income is increasing the footfall, increasing the number of visitors. Enormous number of people has to visit. Then income is not only from the entrance ticket from the visitor. Income comes from many other sources. One example, for the Science City back in 1997, when we decided to have some stalls over there and to get some money from the stall owners. I remember we called Coca-Cola and Pepsi-Cola for putting them to compete between themselves. The first question they asked, what would be the expected number of visitors in your Science City? That we need to know before giving our offer. So since then, you know, they know very well how many visitors are coming, what would be the sale, depending on that sale, what profit they will make, then how much of that profit they would be in a position to contribute to Science City. So Science City's income necessarily does not come only from the ticket selling, get selling. It comes from this kind of other supporting activities, which are additional supporting activities. So the point is this. Now, for the self-sustenance, the museums say that they are in a very tough condition with theme parks. The theme parks provide all kinds of entertainment, joy rides, so they are different kinds of joy rides. The people like to go there, enjoy the whole day, enjoy brilliant food there, take some rest, and then ride another one and go spend the whole day with a lot of fun. Why they should come to a museum in a drab exhibition hall and very, very unattractive things arranged there on different walls and move through that one only for education? No, that's not attractive enough. So museums are in tough competition with theme parks. Straight from the cyberspace, lot of people, they are now getting all information relating to a museum by sitting at home through internet. Why should they really, in these hot summer days, should they come to the museum over there? They get all information over there, sitting at home. So cyberspace has come up as a big competitor to museums. Some museums feel like that. And some of them caution. I remember around 1998, 1999, 2000, a series of articles came up in different publications around the world, cautioning that the museums and science centers are going to have the fate of dinosaurs, that the animals, the creatures, which could not adjust to the changing situation. True that the situation is changing enormously. Islam first mentioned that one. Now, with this changing situation, If the museums cannot adapt themselves to that one, they will be extinct. Nobody would come and visit the museum in any longer. During those 2-3 years, and then the interest subsided, but during those 2-3 years, plenty of publications came up over there. Are museums going to be dinosaurs in the future? Now, these are probably the most threatening factors the museums are facing, that as challenges. Now, how they would be faced, how they would be counteracted, that's a different subject, and I'm not going to discuss that one. That would take a lot of time. Only to remind you, yes, true, the people love to see cinema in the TV instead of taking the trouble to go to a public cinema hall. But still the people are going to public cinema hall. Not that they have deserted the public cinema hall. Look at this INOX. You know, the people are still going there. Why they are going there? If we understand that thing, then that would help us in probably redesigning our museums. Why they are going? They are going there to have a feel of the environment. Maybe some kind of immersive visualization they are going to have there in that hall with that big screen, with a different kind of atmosphere. They are feeling that they are a part of the thing which is happening on the screen, which they do not feel in case of small screens sitting in their bedrooms. Could be that's one the reason why they are still going to the cinema hall. And are they going to museums? Equally like they are going to theme parks? This is a major issue now. This is my last slide. Most popular public institutions of Calcutta. On your left is Nicco Park. Annual footfall 13.5 lakh. 13.5 lakh of people visit Nicco Park for entertainment, sheer entertainment, for joyrides and spending the day in a very nice manner. On the right, you have Science City. Annual footfall 14.91 lakh. Last year's visitors figure, the director told me last. Yes, sir. Look here. Competing with Nicco Park. Not with 100% entertainment. Little bit of entertainment mixed with science, mixed with science education, very cleverly. Like that old story that the boy who says something and cautions his brother, Dada Faliyai, Phanki Diye Shotke Shekachi. Now these Science City people, Olakin to Phanki Diye Shotke Shekachi. They are not openly saying, we are for science education. They are saying, it's a nice place to spend. Spend the day here. And very cleverly, they are educating the people through fun, through entertainment. Could you do that one in many other places? There are other factors, because there's a lot of other institutions who are doing that one, but still not that, with that kind of success, there are other factors over there. I'm not going into that. But I'm ending my presentation by saying that it is possible. Science City has shown it is possible to compete with the fun and entertainment of Nicco Park, so that we can still attract the people and tell us what we want to say. We can pass on the message to them for becoming a real visitor-friendly institution. Thank you.
Will you take some questions if they have? Anybody? Some questions to ask? Feel free.
I have.
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. So may I ask now?
Yes.
Yes, please.
As per United Nations, India is having population 10 to 24 years, 28%. by 2020, individual median is going to be 39 years. By 2020, 63% population will be young, and with that, this is going to be the youngest country in the world. And we have seen our visitor statistics that we get very thin footfall from that younger age group. And we are expecting our footfall will increase at a constant rate as we plan normally, 80-20% every year. As a visionary, how do you see coming 5-6 years, what kind of action we should take now to cater this population who are not attending the science museums or any other museums that way, and they will be visiting science museums?
As I say, I shall be very brief because this topic can go on for hours. As I say earlier, that there are several factors behind this problem relating to football, relating to catching visitors. I personally think, that's my personal opinion, that DITM is one of the best educational science museums in the world. The education component, if you look at that one, still, Birla Museum is nowhere compared to Science City. Two are same organizations, same people are running these two institutions, a lot of similarities over there. Still, Birla Museum, DITM, is not having anything near that figure. There are other factors also. The factors in science, you know, we all know that for achieving something, there should be some kind of optimum mass. Not very heavy, not very light. Optimum mass, that is very, very important. If we want to attract people, retain the people for a longer time, we have to have that space. That is my personal feeling. We have to have that space, breathing space. I see something, come out, enjoy the outings, do something, run there, eat something, enter into another building and do something over there, come out, enter into another building. Multiple points of interest which Science City provides. So a person enter into the Science City, he is in a position to spend a lot more time than he can spend here in Birla Museum, all confined in some small rooms. They are not suitable for any science museum room. They are residential building, we all know, we fought with that problem from the very beginning. So in some small rooms, all arranged in a small manner, we don't have the experience of something very large, this kind of thing. There are other factors. To me, it is a very, very important point that for becoming self-reliant, financially self-reliant, today he gave me a figure, director gave me a figure, that the budget, you know, Science City's budget for outsiders. Science City does not take a single paisa from government. Not from government of Bengal, not from government of India, no. Science City earns through their activities 18 crores of rupees per year, Spain 18 crores. Okay? Now, for doing that one, the museums have to have that kind of facility, that kind of optimum mass space for earning 18 crores. This is my issue. That's not possible everywhere. Apart from that one, the forward-looking planning and other things. The most important point is this, that to me, the changes in the society are to be taken care of, I mean, to be studied very carefully how the people are changing, how their activities are changing, how their minds are changing. For example, today, the little boys of class 3 and class 4, if you have noticed over there, how fluent, how masterly they are on computers. We have not seen this 10 years ago. Forget about our time. There was no computer in the country. So, how they are doing that one? When you were mentioning about that young generation and country would be having more younger people, how their life is changing over there, for the young generation. If we keep a watch on that one and then plan our activities, plan our exhibits to make it interesting for them. The people, the younger people who are so fluent and who are mesmerized by operation on this laptop over there, what do they get if they visit India Museum? My strong criticism is that they don't get anything over there. Provide them this kind of facilities, they would love to go there, they would love to play with that kind of thing, they would love to remain for a much longer time over there. So it depends, the simple example is this, it depends on the science museums, are we going to provide that kind of fascinating experience, participation to the younger generation for luring them to our museum? If we can do that one, we will succeed. If we fail, they will not come. Here is the place that I have seen in science museums. It is the children who come to the museum first, parents come later. Children first visit to the science museum is the organized school visit. They come over there, they get excited, they go back and talk about this place. Oh, we have been there in the morning, you know, this is a very interesting place. So that kind of interest is to be created. Small example. People who were with me at the time of the inauguration of Science City at Calcutta. I.K. Gujral came from Delhi in the morning. I.K. Gujral was Prime Minister to open this Science City and he would go back in the evening. He came with his grandson, about 13, 14 years old. He came with his grandson. He saw that one grandson was visiting there. Okay. After the program was over, Gujral was to go to some other program in the city, from there straight to the airport and fly back to Delhi. This young boy, he refused to accompany his grandpa. No, that was his grandson, yes. His grandpa, he said, no, I would prefer to stay here. Yeah. So Gujral asked him, can you take care of him? He said, oh, don't worry. He would meet you in the airport right in time. We'll take care of him. The whole day the boy was with our colleagues in the Science City while his grandfather was doing something else. Fine. The boy went back. Within less than a week, 4 or 5 days, I received a call from Prime Minister's residence. Can you come day after tomorrow here? Prime Minister is very much interested in developing, in setting up a science city in Punjab. Can you come day after tomorrow? Prime Minister called the Chief Minister and the Chief Secretary of Punjab for this meeting. I rushed over there in Prime Minister's house. The meeting was held. And then Prime Minister said, it is because of my grandson. He insisted that in Punjab we should have this kind of thing, grandpa. So I thought that if an institution can catch really these young people like that, we should have this model. Catch them young. You'll be success. Okay?
Yeah, please.
Just a small follow-up on that, really. Like, I totally agree that from observation, we realize, okay, these are the things other kids would like. But my question or suggestion